stand before your maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is a God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Joy, come and lift your hands and praise your voice. He's worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King. Children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood, bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let us go. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. Worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King. Trembling, joy. All our sickness, all our sorrow, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. Oh, thank God he's walking with us still. Turning tragedy into triumph, turning blessing in the battle. So take heart, stand amazed. Rejoice. When you cry to him, he hears your voice. Oh, he will wipe away your tears. Rejoice. In the midst of suffering, oh, he will help us sing.
Higher. That song, and one of the things I love about that song is it makes explicit something that I think about all the time, and actually we talk about pretty often around here too, and that is the power of doing what we do when we come together as a community and we sing these songs. And there's something about doing that that just reminds us of things that we should know and things that we should remember, and just the process of singing it kind of reiterates and reintegrates truth into my soul, reminds me, and that's not a new thing. In fact, it's a pretty old thing. There's this document in the Hebrew scriptures that's a document that's, they're all songs. They're all songs or psalms. In fact, it's called the Book of Psalms. And one of my favorite psalms, dating back like 3,000 years, imagine that, is by David. You might have heard of him before. And we're going to throw it up on the screen. And this is what this psalm is all about. David is actually talking to himself. He's talking to himself, and he's reminding his soul of what his soul needs to remember. And I thought we could just read, all of us just read this psalm out loud together tonight. There's a few slides. We'll read through it. Let's read it together. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being. Praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and do not forget the good things he has done. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who revere him, for he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust, but from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who revere him. So praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul.
Me, though my days
Let's pray together tonight. Lord, I thank you that we have a chance to do what we just talked about. We can remind ourselves, remind our souls, remind one another of who you are, of who you've been, who you will always be, the one who is good, who is faithful, who is pursuing us. And so we thank you that we can rest in that. And that's what we want to do right now. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, hey, everybody, it is really good to see you. It's great to be with you. I want to welcome you to Terra Nova and say thanks for hanging with us this evening. Hey, I want to toss out a question before you take a seat and give you a chance to interact. And so this week to come up, it's going to be officially fall. And so I've got a question for you, and it's, what are one of your favorite things about fall? And so maybe for you, as you think about that, you go, there's a few different things. You go to fall sports. You love fall sports, and so that's your favorite thing. Or you go, it's this fall weather that we have. It was only like 83 today. It's, ooh, you need a sweater for this weather, right? And so maybe it's that. Maybe you like all things pumpkin spice, and so it's the fall treats. Or maybe it's actually what you love about fall is these fall life groups. Who knows? And so go ahead, say hey to somebody, introduce yourself, and then ask them what's their favorite thing about fall. Once again, it is great to have you with us. If you're watching online, thanks for tuning in and being a part of what we're doing. I want to welcome you again to Terra Nova. My name is Scott, and we are so thrilled that you're with us. There's always a million things you could be doing with your weekend, and so we're happy that you've joined us here at Terra Nova. And so I want to welcome you. We got a great weekend. This morning, we had a bunch of us out at our Lake Forest cleanup day, and so that was a lot of fun. Good group out there for that. We've got a group that's at the Orange County Rescue Mission's Village of Hope right now, serving a meal. And then we've got another group of young adults who are out on a retreat up in the mountains right now. So great weekend around Terra Nova, and as we tonight are going to be jumping into part two of Relationship Rehab. Again, so happy to have you with us. And if you happen to be newer to Terra Nova, if this is one of your first times with us, I want to say thank you so much for being our guest. It always means a lot to have you just kind of checking things out. And so we are grateful that you're with us. We hope you have a fantastic experience. And one of the things that we aim to do is hand everybody one of these guys. This is what we call our weekend program. So if you got a weekend program on your way in, what I'd love to have you do is just pull it out right now, and you can open it up. You'll see a few different things, including we've got a dessert night that's coming up, as well as a baptism. But the first thing I'd love to have you do is to find this flap right here on the end. We call this our Connect card. And so if you can find that, you want to fold it over like I'm doing, you can tear it off. And this is an all play. We love hearing from everybody every week on this Connect card, but especially if you happen to be newer, it would be such a treat to get this from you. You can fill out as much information as you feel comfortable sharing, throw your name. If there's any questions you have, things you'd like to talk with somebody about, you can write that there on the back. But again, this is something that we would love to get from everybody this week. And so you can spend some time working on that Connect card, and we would love to hear from you throughout the evening, and we'll get that from you a little bit later on. But one of the things that I mentioned earlier on is one of the things that we like doing around the fall season is jumping into our fall life groups at Terra Nova. And so you'll notice in your program, we've got one of these life group brochures. And last week we talked about the way that we believe life is always better, it's fuller, it's richer when we are living in community. That it's great to be here and to be sitting in rows, but to join up and to share life in circles, man, something transformative happens. And so you can go ahead, pull out this life group brochure. And one of the things that I wanted to point out this week is that we have so much variety in the different groups that you will find here. And so as you're opening it up, you'll see that we've got groups on Sundays and Mondays and just about every group or every week during, every day during the week. There it is. You'll find groups for that. We've got groups for people who go, you know what, I want to do something active. I want to play pickleball. I want to run. I want to go biking. So we've got groups that are active. We've got groups for people who want to take our weekend series and go, I want to dive into that and discuss that a little bit more, or specific content different groups are doing. We've got groups for ladies, groups for guys, groups for couples, groups for everybody to jump into. We've got groups for young adults, including a new one that we're launching on Thursday nights. That's going to be a lot of fun. We've also got this group, and it's actually the first one you'll see here. It's a group called Starting Point for anybody who's maybe newer or new to faith, or you've got some questions that you want to wrestle through with a group of people. And so we just are pumped to have just a great variety of groups. And one of the things that I think that it communicates is that no matter who you are or where you're at in life, is that there is a place for you to jump in and be a part of community here at Terra Nova. And I love being a church like that. And so what I would invite you to do is this week, spend some time looking through this brochure. Maybe tonight, if you find a group or two that you go, hey, I want to be a part of that, what you'll do is to sign up. You'll flip to the very back. You'll see we've got our sign-up form here, and you can just indicate the groups that you'd like to be a part of. We'll take this whole thing from you a little bit later on. We'll let you know details on that. And also, if you've got your Terra Nova app or you want to jump in and sign up online, we've got that on our website as well. But again, we can't wait just to be this community that's sharing life together and growing as we continue to pursue God on our spiritual journeys. And so we've got that. And once again, I want to thank you for being with us. And right now, we're going to jump into part two of our series called Relationship Rehab. Let's check it out.
Hey, welcome to Terra Nova. Great to see you guys. My name is John, and before we jump in, really excited for what we're talking about tonight. But before we jump in, I wanted to personally extend to you guys an invitation to a dessert night that we're having at my house next Sunday night. It's like an open house type of thing. It happens anytime between 6 and 8 p.m., even if you can only drop by for a few minutes. If you got kids, bring them. If you don't have, like, you can bring a dessert if you want to share a dessert, or you can just come and bring yourself and enjoy all of the desserts that are going to be there. And we would just, my wife and I and our team will be there, our staff will be there. We would just love a chance to hang out with you guys a little bit more than we normally do. So if you got a little time next Sunday night, who knows, maybe even the game will be on TV, drop by, and I'd love to have you over at our house. But Scott said, we are in part two of our series, Relationship Rehab, today. And last week, we kicked off saying, I think, the obvious, that relationships, even the best of relationships, when you think about it, relationships can be hard. Isn't that true? Relationships can be kind of challenging, kind of difficult. And I think the real problem of relationships is a problem of perspective, because wouldn't you agree? I think we can all relate to this. Here's the problem. They see things their way, and you see things the right way. Isn't that true? Like, they see things their way, you see things the right way. And since that's true, the obvious need in every relationship, every challenging relationship, every disagreement, every conflict, every struggle, the obvious need is, okay, so how do I get people to see things my way? How do you get people to see things your way? Which, of course, by the way, is the right way. And hence, we said last week, comes the C4 approach to relationship management, where we seem to instinctively or intuitively go to convince, convict, coerce, control, convince, convict, coerce, control. So we've convinced, like, explain and re-explain and argue the point and inform. And then there's this kind of manipulative thing we're able to do, maybe with self-pity or shame or blame shifting, where we kind of pass that on to them, coercing them, trying to persuade them to do what they do not want to do, using various leverage tactics to do so, and ultimately control. And why wouldn't you control them? After all, you're right. You're right, aren't you? And if they could just see things your way, then everything would be okay. And so we reach for this C4 again and again and again, knowing that it doesn't work, knowing that so often it blows up in our face, and we do that because we're insane. It's true, because you know the definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. This time it will work. This time the C4 will not blow up in my face. And that's why we kicked off this series last weekend, saying that just like with physical rehab, if you've ever had to rehab after an injury or a surgery, just as physical rehab is so often just counterintuitive, counter-natural, counter-instinctive, and you probably are going to need some outside advice, some expertise. In the same way, rehabbing a damaged relationship is a learned skill. It is a learned skill. The steps and skills required to mend damaged relationships do not come naturally. They do not come obviously, and they do not come easily. It is so much easier to reach for a little C4 and blow the thing up than to rehab a relationship as I'm damaging it so that it'll be healthy and strong. And yet, these skills are so essential for messed up people like me, so essential and so critical to develop them, because we are all damaging our relationships all the time. I do not go through a week without needing to apologize, back the bus up, you know, figure out how I'm gonna mend something that I shouldn't have said or an attitude that I didn't need to have. We are damaging relationships, even the best of our relationships, in big and small ways on a weekly, if not a daily basis. At least I am. And so this is a series about the three decisions of relationship rehab. The three decisions of relationship rehab, which I said last week, this is just good advice. This is just wise. It's practical, rooted in the wisdom of Scripture, reinforced with current research into social psychology and communication, cooperation, and conflict resolution in the business world, in the social sector, in the interpersonal relationship world. And this is just stuff, it's just true, it's just good stuff, whether you're a God, faith, Bible, church person or not. But here's the hook. We said last week, if you do happen to call yourself a follower of Jesus, this isn't just good stuff, this is non-optional stuff. It's like non-optional for people who call themselves followers of Jesus, because for us, for followers of Jesus, reconciliation is one of the fundamental foundational concepts of our worldview, of how we see life and history and reality all around us, that we all collectively and individually have been at odds with our Creator, with God Himself. We have all in our own ways gone our own way. In the words of the prophet Isaiah, we've all pushed God away in our own ways, and God came to us. God came to us to reconcile, not just to forgive us, but to restore and mend the relationship with us. God was so committed to the relationship with us that He made the first move. And God came all the way to us. Now, here's how one of the earlier followers of Jesus, his name is Paul. We talk about Paul quite often because he was one of the most influential of the first followers of Jesus. And he's capturing how the first Christians were coming to understand the mind-boggling love and humility of God, that He would do this. And so in this letter that he writes to a community of Jesus followers in the city of Philippi, which was a city in Greece, but it was a Roman colony, so it was a very Roman city in Greece, and he writes this letter to a Jesus community that's starting to grow and form there, and we're jumping into the middle of the letter when I read this, which is never a good idea. You never want to start something in the middle, right? But he's talking about relationships, which he did all the time, because again, this is non-optional for followers of Jesus. And here's how he puts this. I'm going to kind of come in the middle of this, and here's what he's saying. He's saying this: do nothing in your life out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Now, he's tapping into a couple of very well-known words, a couple of very well-known ideas in Greco-Roman life. This phrase, selfish ambition, is actually the translation of the Greek word eretheia. Let me hear you say eretheia out loud. Eretheia, 1, 2, 3. Eretheia. And it's kind of selfish. We don't actually have an English word exactly for this, because it was a very specific idea that's like politicking. It's the machinations and intrigues and scheming and manipulations and maneuverings around people just trying to get into office, trying to get power. In other words, like, that's not a new thing. That's been going on for a really long time, and they had a word for it. Eretheia. Let me hear you say that again. Now you know. It's like That's Arimathea. And how yucky is that? Because who wants to be a part of a relational circle that's got all this politics? When we use terms like office politics, that is not a good thing. It's Arimathea. It's people just like maneuvering and scheming. How yucky that is. And then he pairs Arimathea up with another word that we're translating here, vain conceit, and it's the term kinodoxia. And kinodoxia is like two words put together. Doxia is glory. Kino is just empty. And so it's like empty pride. It's puffing yourself up, trying to make myself look a little bigger, trying to be bigger than I am. And it's this, in other words, he's saying, do nothing in your life. Let your life never be driven or motivated by a desire to push yourself forward, a desire to puff yourself up, a desire to take advantage of others or to scheme or manipulate your way into something, which is what C4 is doing all the time, right? Instead, he says, and then he says something very un-American. It's very un-American, but it was also very un-Greco-Roman. He says, instead, in humility, you value or you regard other people like higher than yourself. Now, you may or may not know this, but humility was actually not a virtue in the ancient world. It wasn't a virtue at all. In fact, it was like a counter virtue. Wait, so to lower myself beneath my rightful status and station in life, to lower myself beneath people who are beneath me in order to elevate them, that was not considered a virtue. In fact, that was kind of considered dangerous. These Christians were messing with the social fabric. They were messing with the ladder. This was socially disruptive. He's like, don't ever push yourself forward. In fact, you do the opposite. In humility, you push other people forward. And you elevate everyone else around you, not yourself, not, he says, not looking to your own interest. But I love this phrase. And here, literally, the phrase reads, not looking out for yourself, but each of you looking out for the others. Isn't that a great idea? Each of you looking out for the others. And if you knew everyone was looking out for you, you would not have to look out for yourself. Isn't that true? What would it be like to live in a community like that? And then he brings it together like this, which lays the foundation for it. And he lays the foundation for that idea this way. He says, so in your relationships with one another, have the same mentality as Christ Jesus had. The same mentality. Exactly. What was it? So Paul, what was that mentality? What mentality that Christ Jesus had when it came to his relationships with us? Now, here in this next part, a lot of scholars think Paul is beginning to quote the lyrics of an ancient song that Jesus' followers had written to try to capture what God had done in coming to us. And here's how Paul lays this out. What was Jesus' mentality? He says, who, talking about Jesus, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be seized upon or held onto or leveraged for his own advantage, but rather he made himself nothing. He made himself nothing. He emptied himself and took on the very nature of a slave, which is a very distasteful word in our world and in theirs, taking on the nature of a slave, being made in human likeness, and then being found in human likeness, he humbled himself even further and became subservient to death, even death on a Roman cross. The shame, the torturous, violent, shameful tool of oppression, God himself made himself subservient to. And it's this mind-boggling idea that in the person, the real human person of Jesus, God himself was actually somehow doing this, coming to us. In the line we looked at last week from a different letter that Paul wrote, that God was in Christ reconciling the whole world to himself, not counting people's sins against them, that God was so committed to the relationship with us that he made the first move back all the way back. And this, we said last week, is really the first decision of relationship rehab, that I will make the first move back regardless of who first moved away. I will do that because that's what Jesus' followers do. I will make the first move back regardless of who moved away. It's what Jesus' followers do. And we do this in part because this is what God did for me. This is what God has done for us, that God was so committed to his relationship with us that he made the first move back. And he didn't just invite us out for coffee and a conversation. He came all the way to us, humiliated himself, humbled himself, and descended into our world, our way of life, our mess. The hole that we had dug came all the way down inside it, all of our brokenness, until it actually all happened to him. And he took it all upon himself, humbling himself even further beyond that, until the greatest humiliation of them all, a crucifixion on a Roman cross, the greatest humiliation imaginable. And then the song goes on to say, what Paul and others had come to see, and they're riffing on the prophet Isaiah as they sing this part of the song, that what was the moment of Jesus's greatest humiliation was actually his moment of exaltation. They were coming to see that his moment of greatest humiliation was actually his moment of exaltation, his true moment of glory, not kenodoxia, not empty glory, but true glory. That's what glory looks like. But here's the point. Here's the point of Paul quoting the lyrics of this song to us. What's your point, Paul? What are you trying to say? Well, he's trying to say, well, you have the same mentality. In your relationships, in all your relationships with other people, you just have the same mentality as Christ, as Jesus the Messiah did that. He was modeling something for us, modeling a way of thinking, modeling mentality that we as his followers are all to have. In other words, if you are following Jesus, if you call yourself a follower of Jesus, then you and I are following him down that path. That's where we're following him, climbing down off our ladder, climbing down off our high horse, climbing down off of our position of superiority, real or imagined. For Jesus, that position of authority or superiority was real. For us, mostly imagined, let's be honest. But either way, we embrace that same mentality and we say, that's what we do. That's what I do as a matter of life, climbing down off our ladder and into their world and their reality. And the word for that, or at least one of the words for that process, is the word empathy. Empathy, empathy. Psychology Today defines empathy as the experience of understanding another person's condition from their perspective. It's climbing down that ladder until I am now in their world, seeing it through their eyes. I'm like trying through my imagination and the best I can to place myself in their shoes to see whatever this is, if I can possibly do so, the way they might see it, to feel it the way they might feel it. Empathy, empathy. Now I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, I don't want to do that. In that relationship, that like that damaged relationship, I don't want to do that because then I'll start to feel all sorry for them. And I don't want to feel sorry. I want to feel mad. I think I should. I like being mad. And if I listen to their sob story and walk a mile in their shoes and the childhood he had and the bad day she had and, you know, hurt people, so they must have been hurt, then I'm going to have, if I feel all that, I'm going to have to excuse what they did and what they said. And it's inexcusable. No, you won't. No, you won't. Empathy is about understanding. It is not about excusing. And like the counterintuitive, very unnatural steps that you have to take when you're rehabbing something physically, empathy is essential for relationship rehab. Empathy is essential for rehabbing any relationship. And here's why. The reason why is because we all have our own story. We all have our own story, right? Our own story of the damage, our own story of how it went down and who did what and why they did it, our own story of the relationship. And there is a brilliant model for understanding this and how this story gets formed in our head. It was created by a guy named Chris Argyris from Harvard Business School. It's actually developed as a business model. And every few years, I like to unpack this because it's so brilliant. It's called the ladder of inference, the ladder of inference. And you can Google it. There's so much on this. this idea, but here's kind of how it works. At the bottom of the ladder on the ground level is what he calls the observable data. And the idea here is this would be what would be observable to a video camera, like an emotionally neutral video camera. So if we were all standing around in some big 360 panorama with our phones out, while that conflict went down, while he said and she said, this is what all of our cameras would pick up, right? So he walks in and there's a pile of clothes on the floor and the sound of kids fighting in the background and someone's crying and the clock says whatever and he has a look flash across his face and she says five words. It's like, well, what does that mean? We don't know. It's just a video camera. None of that really means anything yet. The look, the clock, the words, what does it mean? Well, Argris says, then immediately and instinctively, here's what happens. I select certain data. I select data, I see and hear selectively. I do. I don't notice certain things. I don't know why I don't notice them. There were things that happened before I even walked into the room, things that I don't know, and then I see and hear only certain things. But then I not only select the data, I add meaning to it because I start to go, here's what that means. Here's what that means based on my own understanding or my culture or my rules or my personality or what's important to me. Here's what that means to me. And then I make assumptions. I start to add things to that of what else might be true. I make assumptions about you. I do a lot. And there's names and labels that might get added in. And then I draw conclusions. So I kind of tie it up in a bow and I say, so this is how it is. And this is how that was. And now I know. And now I know about, yeah, like don't tell me. And I add those conclusions to my beliefs. And that becomes the truth for me. My beliefs, that's the truth. And then he says, a dangerous thing happens. My beliefs form, let's go back down a second. My beliefs form a reflexive loop, this reflexive loop where what I believe actually informs the data that I will select in the future. Because of what I believe to be true, there will be certain things I notice and certain things I don't notice. And then out of all of that, top of the ladder, I take actions. I take actions. I begin to behave a certain way. I start to say or do certain things in the relationship from the top of my ladder. The look came across his face. The five words came out of her mouth and it is on. Like actions start to fly, right? From the top of the ladder. Or you walk into the kitchen and you know that your roommate, or at least you believe that your roommate was just in there making some food and it's all still out, and you in an instant are on top of a ladder. I mean, you have added all that together in a moment's notice. Now, a couple quick observations before we move on. All the steps between 1 and 7 happen where? All the rungs of the ladder, where do they exist? In my head. It's all happening in my head and only in my head. I think it's the truth. I think it's factual. I think it's observable. It's just a story. It's a story that I have told myself. Perhaps it's a story based on a true story, but it is not a true story. And here's the thing, you have a different story. You climbed a different ladder in a different direction, and your story, consequentially, it is a different story of the same thing. Why is empathy so essential to any kind of healthy relationship or relationship we have? Well, because we all have a story, and our stories are different. And here's what you already know. In our story, our behavior makes sense. In our story, our behavior makes sense, right? However we've pieced the story together, our actions make sense at the top of our ladder. It's like, yeah, I say this all the time because it's true. Even when I know I'm being a little crazy, and sometimes I do, my story makes sense of me being crazy right now. There is a good reason why crazy is okay. And here's what you know in their story, or you need to know this. Their behavior makes sense. In their story and their version of that, it makes all the sense in the world, which should make you incredibly curious about how they've told that story. A final observation, it kind of goes with the second one. And in our story, we're the hero. Aren't we? We are always the hero. We are the protagonist. We are right. We're justified. We're the victim here. And the other person is the problem. They're the villain and they're being selfish or naive or controlling or lazy or irresponsible or irrational or stubborn. I mean, they are a problem person in the relationship. And in their story, they are the protagonist and I am the problem. They're their own protagonists. I'm the problem, and that's the problem. That's the problem. That's the conflict right there, that every conflict really is a conflict of two stories. Every conflict is a conflict of two stories, and as long as we can only look at it from our side, nothing ever gets settled. Nothing ever gets better, and we just lob C4 at each other from the tops of our ladders, and we trade our conclusions and beliefs with one another, which, by the way, are always unconvincing to the other person, because my conclusions and beliefs only make sense at the top of my ladder. And they're standing on a different ladder. My conclusions and beliefs don't make any sense on the top of their ladder. And so it goes nowhere and nothing ever gets settled. Round and around we go. Can you relate? Has that ever happened to you? And that's why empathy becomes the essential skill of relationship rehab. And we kicked off the series last week looking at some words from the Apostle Paul, the guy I was quoting a little bit earlier, from a different letter, from his letter to the Romans. And he says this in that letter. We looked at this last week. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Just never go there. Never go for the repaying evil for evil. Never try to get even with someone's evil. Because you know why? When you are evil with someone who's been evil, you are evil. If you get even with someone's evil, well, now you're evil too. Like, he's like, don't go there. Instead, you be the person who always does the right thing. Whatever they've done, however wrong they've, you are, in fact, you have to give thought to it. It's intentionality, but you become, in the eyes of everyone, the person who just has this reputation of, you know, she just always does the right thing. You know, he just always, I know that was messed up, but you know what? He's going to do the right thing. He's going to do the noble thing. You let that be you. And then he says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, you live at peace with everybody. You live at peace with everybody, which raises the question, as far as it depends on you, what depends on you? What depends on you? And the answer is, well, at least three things. At least three things. There are three decisions that you can always make that depend on you and only you. And the first one is the first decision of relationship rehab. I'll make the first move back. And we do that according to Jesus, regardless who made the first move away. Regardless of who made the first move away, we are always the ones that say, I will pursue peace. I will pursue reconciliation. When you've been wronged, Jesus says, you go first. If you've done the wronging, then you go first. And if there's been so much wrong done that you can't even remember who started the wrong and that the wrong has gone round and round, well, you go first. You be the one that pursues peace and reconciliation. And I can always do that. I can always make that decision. In fact, as a follower of Jesus, I must assume this posture that I am always going to pursue, if it is possible, and it isn't always possible, I'm going to be the one that pursues peace in the relationship. It's the first decision of relationship rehab. And the second one that we all can do, this depends on me. It is a choice that I can make, is this. I will seek first to understand before I try to be understood. I will seek first to understand before I even try to be understood. And the tension here is the tension between what's sometimes described as inquiry versus advocacy. Inquiry versus advocacy. And advocacy is all about me trying to be understood. Advocacy is all about me advocating my position and the rightness of my point of view, because clearly I'm right, explaining and re-explaining and sending you articles and here's a book and you need to watch this podcast and asserting my view. And if you could only see things my way, which is the right way, everything would be okay. And advocacy thrives on C4. And advocacy thrives on like convincing and convicting and coercing and controlling and saying things like, advocacy says, well, you just don't understand. You don't understand. You got it all wrong. You need to understand me. Inquiry, on the other hand, is me trying to understand you. Not advocating my point of view, but me really legitimately trying to understand yours. Like, how in the world is what you were doing and saying right now making any sense at all? You must have an incredible story. I got to hear that story. I am so curious what your ladder must look like for you to have reached the conclusions that you have reached. You got to tell me more. I want to hear this. And I begin to replace my certainty with curiosity. I replace my conclusions with curiosity. Let me ask you this. You think about that relationship that's been a little difficult lately. Is it possible that their behavior has a logical explanation? Is it possible you're like, no, there's no way. It's stupid. They're being like, it makes no sense. It's irrational. It's worse than irrational. It's evil. There's no way it has a logical explanation. Let me ask the question a slightly different way. Is it possible their behavior has a logical explanation to them? Is it possible it has a logical explanation to them? To which you might go, well, yeah, it might have a logical explanation to them. Ashley Montague is an anthropologist, has this famous quote. There's the to them. Here's the quote. This famous quote, human beings, I love this, are the only creatures who are able to behave irrationally in the name of reason. It's true, like dogs don't do that. Other animals don't behave irrationally in the name of reason. We are uniquely gifted with the ability to behave irrationally in the name of reason. Is it possible that their behavior has a logical explanation to them? See, and seeking to understand begins with me starting to consciously climb down off my ladder. To consciously climb off of my ladder, realizing I've made up a story, realizing I have been selective in my data. I do not hear it all. I do not see it all. I may have heard and seen wrong, even though I'm so sure I didn't. I might be wrong. I might not have gotten that right, and I probably don't have all the facts, and I know I have added my own meaning. I have added what that means to me through my lens, and I've made assumptions, and I came to some conclusions, and I think I know what went down, and I added those to my beliefs, and it is the truth. But I am way too smart to think that's true. And I am climbing down off my ladder and I begin to humble myself because this is a humbling posture to take. I begin to trade my pride for humility, my certainty with curiosity, and I climb down off my high horse and I climb down off of my position of superiority in order to enter that other person's world and to enter their story. Is it possible that this makes sense to them? I have to hear how. Now, the problem, of course, is that the other person's story is really confusing. It's confusing. It makes no sense to us because they climbed a completely different ladder. And so often, they lack the ability to adequately tell their own story and the ability to kind of trace their own path up a ladder. And worse than that, we often both lack the awareness that it actually is a story and not the truth, that we've even done this in our own head. Well, there's a collection of wise sayings in the Hebrew scriptures known as the Book of Proverbs. It's a lot of these just kind of one-off, one-liner sayings. And one of my favorite of these sayings of wisdom, these Proverbs, is this one. It's Proverbs 25, and it says this: the purposes of the human heart are like deep waters. Now, that's not meaning like, oh, you're a deep person. No. Deep waters in the ancient world was always a symbol of chaos and confusion and darkness and mystery. And the proverb is saying that our purposes, our desires, our motives, the things that drive us are a lot like that. It's like this deep, dark well, and you're looking in there going, I have no idea what's down there. It's just dark. I can't see a thing. And that's what it's like. That's what we are all like. Like, who knows what we really want? I am often or almost always not self-aware enough to even connect the dots of what's driving me right now. What's gotten me so tweaked in this moment? I can't even see into my own heart that well very often, let alone the other person's heart that I assume so clearly I understand. And the proverb says, oh, no, you don't. It is deep waters, but a person of understanding, a person with wisdom, a person with understanding knows how to drop a bucket down in that well and pull meaning out and pull understanding out and pull that purpose out. The person of understanding knows how to get that out of that deep, dark well. And it's often some combination of the three magic words. And these are three of my favorite words. In fact, I use them so often, I have some friends that roll their eyes every time we do. The three magic words are, help me understand. Help me understand. What wonderful words those are. Like, hey, seems to me we like, we seem to have a really different way of seeing this right now. Like we're really seem to be kind of far apart. Help me understand. Help me understand how you got there. Help me understand your view. When you said that way, that wasn't how I saw it. I didn't think of it that way. What led you to that? What got you up that ladder? What took you, like what data are you looking at, or what did you think you heard? Help me understand. I think I heard, what I thought I saw was, I felt this way. Help me understand. Help me understand. The members of the Harvard Negotiation Project, in their super helpful best-selling book, Difficult Conversations, one of my favorite books on all of this content, put it this way. They said, to get anywhere in a disagreement, to get anywhere in a damaged relationship, if you will, we need to understand the other person's story well enough to see how their conclusions make sense within it. In order to get anywhere, we need to understand the other person's ladder, the other person's story well enough that we can see how their conclusions make all the sense in the world in the context of that story. And as difficult as it is, from the top of my ladder with all of my assumptions and judgments I've made, I begin to replace my certainty with curiosity and my pride with humility. And I ask myself, I wonder how they see it. I wonder, it must make sense to them. I wonder how. I want to hear that. If they were to frame our conflict in their own words, I wonder how they would say that. And I seek first to understand. I seek first to understand, to really empathically understand before I even try to be understood. Now, at this point, if I were you, I might be thinking, okay. So their story, and they have a story, and then makes sense to them. There's a reason why they did that. And inquiry, and I need to understand empathy. What about me? Like, I got a story. Like, stuff happened here. I've got my own story. Hey, John, is there a time for me to advocate? Like, my story and my point of view and my thoughts and my concerns, is there a time for me? And the answer is, well, absolutely. Absolutely. Of course there is. It wouldn't be an honest mutual exchange if there was not advocacy in our conversation. It's the second half of the second decision of relationship rehab. I want to seek first to understand, but then eventually I want to try my best to be understood. It's important to be understood. But here's what's fascinating. Here's what all of the research shows on the listen first, you know, seek first to understand approach versus the C4 advocacy approach. Here's what all the research shows, that when people feel understood, they become better at understanding. When people feel understood, they actually get a whole lot better at understanding. You listening to them helps them listen to you. And in fact, it's like giving them oxygen, because until you have oxygen, you can't think of anything else. And once you have oxygen, you're not even worried about it at all. And when you listen to them, you're giving them oxygen. When they feel understood, they become better at understanding. In fact, sometimes just the first half of the second decision, just the process of understanding, is all that's needed. Case in point, Greta's mom found out about a year ago that she had diabetes, and some of you know what this is like. She was ordered to follow the strict regimen of, there's some medication, and there was diet, and there was exercise. There were these changes that she needed to make, but Greta's mom was not doing it. She was not doing it. In fact, worse, she seemed to like get really defensive and almost like melt down every time Greta brought it up, and she was like, you need to, you know, stop hounding me, and you don't understand, and I'm doing the best I can, and Greta would push back, and she would try to convince and explain and, you know, convict and coerce, and I want you to be alive for the grandchildren, and, you know, this kind of thing, and her mom would just shut down, and it's like, I don't want to talk about it, you need to stop talking to me about it, and round they went, and their relationship was growing more and more tense, as you can imagine, as Greta found herself escalating a little bit more every time. And then Greta got exposed to these ideas that we've just been talking about. This whole thing about empathy and trying to understand where the other person's perspective and feelings might be, and the ladder of inference, and they have a story, and I have a story. It's seeking to understand. And of course, Greta assumed she did understand, and you do too, and I do too. Like, of course, I already understand, but maybe there's a little something that I haven't quite understood, so maybe I can understand maybe a little bit better. And so she decided she was gonna shift from advocacy to inquiry. She was gonna shift from trying to convince her mom to trying to understand her mom, this more empathetic approach. And so she tried to start out with empathy. So she started out with, and this is actually a great way to start a conversation like this. I know you don't like talking about this. I know you don't like talking about your diabetes and the exercise and such. And the mom just immediately replied, like, no, I don't. It's a very upsetting to me. And Greta replied, so here's the help me understand. When you say upsetting, like, what do you mean by that? Like, what part of our conversation feels upsetting? What does that mean to you? And she's like, everything. Everything is about it is upsetting. You think this is fun? And Greta was like, no, actually, I think it's really hard. I think it's really hard, but it occurs to me I don't actually know much about what you think. I don't know what you think or how you feel about it. And the mom replied, well, if your father was still alive, he would know what to do. If your father was still alive, it would be different. He always took such great care of me when I was sick, when I needed him. He would know what to do. And Greta was like, oh, wow, you miss dad, don't you? You miss him being around. She found her emotions beginning to turn. And the mom replied, well, you know, I have a lot of friends and I have you kids. It's not the same as having your dad around. And I don't want to be a burden to you and the kids. I don't want to be a burden to you. And now that was new information. It had never occurred to Greta that her mom might think she was being a burden to them. And she certainly didn't feel so. So that even made her more curious. And she was like, you feel like you're being a burden to me? Does that feel that way about you? And that's when her mom said, I don't want you to go through what my mom went through when her mom died of diabetes. Ooh, Greta did not know that. She didn't know how her great-grandmother had died. She was like, oh, mama, wow, I didn't know that. And the mom, that opens the door a little bit. And the mom says, like, hey, it's scary being told that you have what your grandma died of. And I know there are medical advancements, but it's hard for me to accept. I don't want to believe it's true. And then she goes on, all the rules and everything, it's the stuff I'm supposed to do, it's complicated and everything affects everything else. So the diet affects how much I exercise, or exercise affects what I eat, and you have to keep track. And your father, he would know what to do. Your father would know. And now Greta has found herself totally emotionally moved towards her mom. And you probably are right now too. And she's like, well, mom, can I help? I mean, maybe I can help. I don't want to be a burden to you, Greta. I don't want to be a burden. Greta's like, oh no, I'd love to. It would actually make me feel better about this. I wouldn't feel so powerless. I would love to help you. Well, if you could, that would take a load off my mind. Now, true story, but I always feel like I should add these little words down here. Actual results may vary. Like that may not, like, it is not a magic wand. Empathy and understanding is not a magic wand, but sometimes it really is true. Just even for myself, I've noticed just the process of me working through in my imagination or in conversation, really understanding the other person, kind of imagining, that's kind of all I needed. That kind of just diffused the whole thing. And even when it doesn't resolve it, and maybe most of the times it doesn't completely resolve it, truly understanding the other person will often reframe the conversation that actually does need to happen. So rather than lobbing C4 of, you know, at each other from the tops of our ladders, going round and around and getting nowhere, you might find yourself after an understanding conversation knowing the conversation you now need to have. And maybe it wasn't the one you thought you needed to have, the one that might actually help things. And that's why empathy is so powerful. It's why empathy is the essential skill of relational health and relational rehab. It's why empathy is so essential for people like me who are constantly damaging relationships, even the most important relationships to me. And can you imagine? just for a moment. Can you imagine if everyone in our world, if everyone in your world did that? Can you imagine what our world would be? Can you imagine how different politics and the political landscape would be if people were that emotionally healthy who were involved in politics? Can you imagine how different the news coverage or social media would be if everyone did that? Can you imagine how different your relational circle, like your family or your extended family or your team or your workmates or such, can you imagine how different that would be? Can you imagine how different that one relationship, you know, that one, that challenging relationship, can you imagine how different that conflict might be if everyone in humility, tracking with the mentality of Christ Jesus himself, sought to climb down off of our ladders and into the other person's world? Can you imagine? But here's the thing, of course, we can't do anything about them. We can't do anything about all of those other people. The only person I really can do something about is me, the person in the mirror. And it's why Paul says, if it's possible, as far as it depends on you, not them, you, as far as it depends on you, you live at peace with everyone. And what depends on you? Well, at least three things. First of all, I can make this decision that I will make the first move back. I will make the first move back regardless of who first moved away. I will always attempt to do the right thing. I will always assume that posture of pursuing reconciliation if it is possible, whatever that means in the moment. And I can and I will seek first to understand. Before I even try to be understood, I will seek the empathy path. I will seek to understand. I will ask better questions. Not leading questions, not gotcha questions, not aha questions. Like legitimate questions. I will replace my certainty with curiosity. And then the third decision, I will come back next week for part three of Relationship Rehab. We will pick it up right there next week as our series winds down, the series finale. But this second decision, of pursuing understanding, it takes us back to the prayer that we closed with last week. And that prayer, if you were here last week, was this: Heavenly Father, help me see, and then you fill in the blank. Help me see, and then you, in your mind, you put that person's name or those people's names, that group, their name. Help me see them the way that you see them. And help me, Heavenly Father, help me feel towards them the way that you feel. And I'm gonna, this week, I need to make some moves toward them, at least inwardly in my own posture, if not outwardly. And for some of that, it's just like, this is just an everyday thing. And for some, this is tough. Like there's emotion to this and there's some pain to this. Father, will you help me? I'm not there yet. I don't see them the way you see them. I know I don't. I don't feel towards them the way you feel. I'm not there yet. Father, will you help me? Will you help me see them the way you see them and feel towards them the way you feel? And with that, I'd like to close us in prayer. And as we bow our heads and close our eyes, like carve out a little space here, maybe bring a couple of relationships to mind that you know can be challenging at times. Maybe they're challenging right now, or maybe there's a relationship where that name has been coming up last week, this week, and that's a tough relationship. There's been some water under the bridge there. And as you bring that person to mind, Heavenly Father, you have surrounded us, even in this room, with people who just see things so differently, who have such different stories, who have such different pains and childhoods and ways of coming to conclusions. And you have given us a standard to live up to, that if it is possible, as far as it depends on us, we will pursue reconciliation. We will pursue peace and wholeness in our relationships. And then you've modeled a mentality for us to embrace, a mentality of humbling yourself into our world. And today we pray for our relationships in our circles. And we pray that you will help us see them the way you see them. And help us, we need your help, to feel towards them the way you feel. And would you give us the awareness this week of our stories in our heads and the wisdom and the insight to understand the stories of others. And I pray that in Jesus' name, amen. Well, hey, once again, thanks so much for joining us tonight. Before you head out, we always say this: if you got anything out of today, you want to see it again, you can always watch it on our YouTube channel, and you can share it with others on our YouTube channel as well. That is a slide that you can click There it is. And by the way, if you got something out of this, invite somebody back with you next week. We'd love to have them for the series finale. And then don't forget, please, to turn in the, if you started filling out that Connect card, we'd love to hear from you. If you're a guest, thank you so much for spending part of your week here with us. And you can also throw that Life Root brochure in the basket. You can throw that Connect card and the brochure in the baskets on your way out. Our guest services teams will be holding that. And of course, you can throw your offering envelopes in there as well as giving online and on our app. And we are just so grateful for the generosity of this community. It's really amazing. And then join us next week for the series finale of Relationship Rehab. Hope you'll come back and join us. God bless you guys. Have a fantastic week. We'll see you back next weekend.